bring in our next speaker, who's Dr. Ramya Tadipatri. She is a neuro-oncology fellow at Barrow Neurological Institute. She majored in biomedical engineering at Cornell University and attended medical school at Weill Cornell Medical College, then completed a neurology residency at Barrow Neurological Institute. She's worked in labs at Cornell University at Brigham and Women's Hospital on breast cancer research, as well as lab at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center on CAR T cells for treating leukemia. She's now focused on treating brain tumor patients with a particular research interest in glioblastoma. Welcome, Dr. Tadipatri.
Thank you so much, Jackie. So I'm with the neuro-oncology department again. We're the department that handles basically the chemotherapy aspect of treatment. Of course, one aspect of managing brain tumor patients is fighting the tumor itself. And another very important aspect, though, is managing the symptoms that that you can get from the brain tumors. So that'll be the focus of my talk today. So symptoms in brain tumor patients and what to do about them. So just kind of an overview, some of the causes of symptoms in brain tumor patients. So that can be due to the actual location of the tumor. It can be from high pressure. It can be from swelling around the tumor. It can be from disruption of electrical activity, what we call seizures, and it can be from medication. So I'm going to go through all those different causes. And then I'm going to go through the symptoms and talk about strategies of how to manage them. And I'm going to close it out with some tips for caregivers. So in order to address that first part of symptoms from the tumor location, it's important to kind of understand the brain structure and function. So I won't go too much in detail, but just kind of general concepts. So the brain is divided into two hemispheres, two halves. You have the cerebrum, and that's divided into four lobes: the frontal lobe, temporal lobe, parietal lobe, and occipital lobe. And so there's a left and right side to each of those lobes. Then you have the cerebellum, and you have the brainstem, which is composed of the midbrain, pons, and the medulla. So just to, and as we saw with Dr. DiDomenico's talk, the different parts of the brain have different functions. So here's a diagram. You can see the frontal lobe. This is kind of a side view. So frontal lobe is in red here. Parietal lobe is in blue. And then you have the temporal lobe in yellow, occipital lobe in green. And the orange part is the cerebellum. And that purple and that kind of light blue color is the brainstem. So I want to draw your attention to this dark red part towards the back of the frontal lobe, that's the motor cortex. And then the dark blue part towards the front of the parietal lobe is the sensory cortex. So the frontal lobe, the symptoms that can be associated with that location, you can get some mood and personality changes. You can get weakness if it involves that motor strip that we saw, and the weakness would be on the opposite side of the body. So if it's on the in the left frontal lobe, that controls your strength on the right side of the body. And it can cause some language difficulty, particularly if it's in the dominant, what's called the dominant hemisphere. For all right-handed people and just about all right-handed people and most left-handed people, that dominant hemisphere is the left side, but a small portion of left-handed people, it's the right side. Then you can have temporal lobe tumors. So that can cause some hearing difficulty and also some forgetfulness. You can have parietal lobe tumors, which can cause numbness. If it involves that sensory strip, and the left parietal tumors affect the right side of the body and right parietal affects the left side of the body. It can also cause some impairment in spatial awareness. occipital lobe tumors, that's again in the back of the brain. So that can cause some vision problems. And it's usually a field cut. So like a part of the vision, like the right side of the vision or the left side of the vision is what's affected. And again, left occipital causes a right field cut and vice versa. Moving on to the cerebellum. So that can cause some dizziness, particularly vertigo. So you'll get like a room spinning sensation or a feeling like you're on a boat. It can cause some problems with coordination and some imbalance. So the brainstem is a very critical structure. It's at that kind of center of the brain where a lot of pathways go through there. So basically the symptoms from the brainstem are kind of all of the above. You can get weakness, numbness, vision or hearing problems, problems with eye movements or facial muscles, shortness of breath, difficulty speaking or swallowing, dizziness, imbalance. So moving on to symptoms from high pressure. So this is a diagram of the skull. So you have these different portions of the skull and they're joined with sutures. So when you're a baby, there are spaces between these different parts of the skull. And that's just to allow your brain to expand. But as you grow older, the parts fuse together. So you have this completely fused structure and it does a great job of protecting the brain, but there's very limited space. So if there's anything in the brain that isn't supposed to be there, like for instance, a tumor, then that can cause some symptoms just from that pressure inside the skull, pressing on different parts of the brain and impairing its function. So with high pressure, some of the symptoms that are classically associated are headache, double vision, lethargy, and confusion. And it'll be very important to tell your doctor if your loved one is having these symptoms. And as far as ways to deal with them, so a shunt can potentially relieve pressure if it's due to not being able to drain the fluid properly, if instead the pressure is due to swelling around the tumor, then you can consider things like steroids or a medication called Avastin or bevacizumab that can help to reduce that swelling. So it's important to identify what's really causing this high pressure. And if it's from the tumor itself, then you might want to talk with the neurosurgeon. So the neurosurgeon will probably talk with you about possibly another surgery and resection to kind of take out the tumor if possible. So seizures, this is basically disruption of the normal electrical activity of the brain. So you can think of it as like an orchestra where you have different instruments and they have to kind of work together and play at certain times to have a symphony. So there has to be a certain pattern to it. Now, if all the instruments just kind of play at once, then you get this kind of jarring, you don't get that symphony. So that's kind of like what a seizure is, where all of your neurons are just firing at once and it doesn't have that normal pattern. So what does it look like for the patient? Now, a lot of people might think of seizures as based on like what they might see in the movies or on TV. So like a whole body shaking and not really responding, but it's important to remember that there are a lot of different types of seizures. So the generalized seizures, this is kind of what most people think of when they think of seizures. So the whole body rhythmic shaking, it can also involve staring spells. These are also often classified as generalized. Focal seizures mean that it comes from a particular part of the brain, usually where the tumor is. So if the tumor is on the left side, then you can have a shaking of just one arm or one leg on the right side of the body. They can also have auras or just kind of unusual sensations that people often have a little trouble describing. And then there's some in-between areas where you can have a focal seizure that can become generalized. So a lot of different types. And so the important thing to remember is if there's any kind of spell where you're, something happens and then you're kind of back to normal afterwards, that's something to bring up with your doctor. So what to do, again, tell your doctor. So small seizures can eventually lead to big ones. And as far as what to do when a patient is having a seizure, so we want to focus on trying to keep them safe. So lay the patient on the ground on his side, so the patient does not aspirate and does not like fall. And if the seizure doesn't stop on its own, there are medications that we can prescribe for breakthrough seizures. So if you have clonazepam or some such medication, you can give that and also call 911. There are a lot of different medications that we use to treat seizures. Some of the more common ones, and this is not a comprehensive list, but these are the ones that we tend to use because they are less likely to interact with any chemotherapy medications. Keppra is kind of our go-to. There's also Vimpat or lacosamide, lamotrigine, and which also known as Lamictal, and clobazam, also known as Onfi. And something that's really important to remember is that we tend to start with Keppra because it's generally the best tolerated, but you know, anyone can have any side effects to medications. So some people, the Keppra causes a lot of side effects. We'll talk about that later, but there are other medications that we can switch to control the seizures hopefully would not get those same side effects. And we also want counsel on the kind of safe behavior when seizures are an issue. So after a seizure, for 3 months, we recommend no driving or high-risk behavior, basically any situation where you would not want to have a seizure. So swimming pools, tall ladders, operating heavy machinery. And so again, can have different side effects, but there are a lot of other options that we can try if that's the case. So the next part of this is medication side effects. So I'm going to talk a little bit about chemotherapy. The one that we use most commonly is temozolomide or Temodar. The side effects that we generally can see with this is fatigue, nausea, and constipation. It can also potentially cause some lowering of your blood counts. So we keep an eye on this with the regular blood work so that we can get ahead of that. If the hemoglobin's low, that can cause some fatigue. If the platelet's low, that can make you more prone to bleeding. And if there's low white blood cells, that can increase your risk of infection. And so these are the things that we watch for that can happen, but many people take the temozolomide and do okay without any side effects. So steroids, these are also can cause a lot of different side effects that can be impairing. So they're very useful and important in kind of addressing that swelling from the tumor, but does come with its own set of side effects. So early on, it can get some insomnia and some mood changes, particularly irritability. later, if with the chronic steroid use, it can cause some weight gain, muscle weakness, and it can cause some bone loss and lead to osteoporosis. So again, very rare, but something that we watch for. With steroid use, so your body makes its own steroids naturally that allows you to produce a stress response. But when we give steroids as a medication, that kind of tells your body you don't need to make those steroids anymore. So when we try to come off of the steroids, then we can see what's called adrenal insufficiency, where your body's kind of dependent on the steroids and has trouble producing a stress response. So this is something we can see with chronic steroid use, which can make it difficult to challenging to try to come off of the steroids. But the way we do this is we can kind of if we see some side effects from decreasing the steroids, we can go back up to the dose that was tolerated and kind of try again later, more slowly, to try and wean the body off of it. So headaches, kind of going through all the different symptoms. So the headaches, again, so it's a very common thing that a lot of people have, but some of the red flags that that might suggest this might be more than just a regular headache. If it starts suddenly, so like a thunderclap, what's called a thunderclap headache, if it's worsening, getting progressively worse, if it's constant and just not going away, if it's worse while lying down. Now, when the headache is from high pressure, basically when you're standing, when you're upright, gravity is kind of working with you to help lower that pressure. When you're lying flat, your blood is kind of rushing to your head, and that can worsen a high pressure, a pressure related headache. And if something just isn't right, this is not your usual headache, that's another thing that could be a red flag. So tell your doctor if that's the case. We have a lot of different medications that we can give to help alleviate the headaches. And many of these are used in treating migraines. So you have medications to prevent headaches. So these are things that we would take regularly, like Topamax, Depakote, amitriptyline, nortriptyline. Can even do kind of a short course of steroids to prevent the headache from coming on. And there are abortive medications to take as needed if you do get a headache. So Tylenol and Advil are to start with, but then we can consider triptans, Furoset, Tramadol. Opiates we try to avoid to reduce kind of the dependency, but something we can do if absolutely necessary. And injections, I can consider Botox or Botox has been approved for chronic migraines, and nerve blocks are another option. So weakness and imbalance. So I wanted to talk briefly about like neuroplasticity. So this is, your brain has an amazing ability to kind of recover from any kind of damage. So either from the tumor or from surgery potentially. So your brain is kind of like a muscle that the more you use it, the more you form new electrical pathways to compensate for the ones that are damaged. So fall precautions are important. If you do walk, make sure that you walk with supervision, someone's around to support, or you use assistive devices like a walker or cane. Therapy, so physical therapy and occupational therapy. So the goals to regain strength. Again, like I said, the forming these new pathways to try and get that strength back. And another aspect, though, is even if that strength isn't regained, you can learn to compensate for the symptoms. As far as putting your weight differently or using other muscle groups. So numbness, there are medications that we can use for numbness, like gabapentin, Lyrica or pregabalin, and then antidepressant medications, which were originally developed to treat depression, but in low doses has been found to affect to help with neuropathies. So the important thing to remember about these medications, though, is that it tends not to help with the numbness itself, but alleviates any kind of pain associated with the numbness, like a burning sensation or like electric shock like pain. Language difficulty. So there are two main language areas. So you can see the Broca's area, which is in the frontal lobe and towards the back of the frontal lobe, and Wernicke's area, which is the the top part of the temporal lobe. So Broca's area controls expressive language. So if the patient is not able to find words as easily, the speech output is not fluent. Then Wernicke's area controls receptive language. So that's difficulty with understanding people. And what to do about this? So speech therapy. So again, similar goals where you try to regain language by forming these new pathways. And also kind of learn to compensate for symptoms. So find other words when the word isn't coming to you. And next, move on to difficulty swallowing or slurred speech. So this can be caused by weakness of the facial muscles, or weakness of the swallowing muscles, or problems with muscle coordination. Sometimes with the swallowing, it's not so much like the motor ability to swallow, but from confusion. So like not really knowing what to do with the food that's in your mouth. And what to do about it. So speech therapy will be important to evaluate whether the patient can swallow safely. So we worry about if they're not able to swallow properly, if the food goes down the wrong tube, it can cause a pneumonia. So we want to make sure for safety reasons that the patient can swallow safely. And it can also help to, the speech therapist will work with the patient to strengthen the speaking and swallowing muscles. And if the patient is not able to swallow safely, we'll sometimes consider a feeding tube to help make sure that the patient's getting nutrition. And this can be removed at a later time if the swallowing ability comes back. Vision complaints. So there's different types. You can have blurry vision, double vision, or visual field cuts. So causes, tumor location is an important cause. So occipital lobe can cause some visual field cuts. The pituitary gland, which we haven't talked much about, is right up against the pathways for vision. So that can also cause some visual field cuts, particularly with the peripheral vision. And the brainstem has pathways that control your eye movements. So the double vision happens when your eyes are kind of pointed in different directions because there's a problem with the eye movements and that causes you to see double. And high pressure can also cause double vision. And the reason is that one of the nerves that controls your eye movements is very vulnerable to high pressure. So what to do about this? Tell your doctor you want to make sure if this is from high pressure that we're on top of things. An optometrist, an ophthalmologist can do more detailed testing to figure out what exactly the problem is with the vision. An occupational therapist can help with working around these the vision issues. Prism glasses can be helpful with the correcting that double vision. And the precautions, avoid driving. And if it's a very mild or subtle field defect, you can consider taking another driving test and seeing if you can still drive safely. Nausea and vomiting. So this can be caused by chemotherapy as a side effect of chemotherapy, or it can be caused by high pressure. And what to do about this? Again, tell your doctor, make sure it's not a high pressure issue. And then medications, there's a wide variety of medications that we can try for this. So Zofran is kind of our go-to to start with, but remember there are other medications if the Zofran is not working for you. Constipation. So chemotherapy, again, a side effect of the temozolomide. Many medications can cause constipation. Dehydration can also be a contributing factor. So make sure you're staying hydrated. Try and increase dietary fiber. Whole grain, fruits, vegetables, legumes all help. And medication, so there's stool softeners like the colace. And if that's not enough, there's you can move on to trying different laxatives, which can all be found over the counter. Insomnia, so the very often caused by steroids and anxiety. Of course, a lot of reasons to be anxious. We'll talk more about kind of the mood symptoms, but that can cause some insomnia. And if there's any kind of distressing symptoms that are preventing you from being able to sleep. So addressing the cause, you can consider a sleep study to check for sleep apnea or other sleep problems. And then sleep hygiene can be beneficial. So things like reducing screen time at night, having a sleep routine, minimizing any time spent in bed during the day, and making sure you get enough natural light so that your body's biological clock doesn't get too confused. Medications, melatonin is one that we start with, and it's a natural hormone that your body produces. So so it's a safe option to try that probably wouldn't expect too many side effects. And there are other medications you could prescribe if that doesn't work. Lethargy and sleepiness. So this can be caused by the tumor location, if it's kind of affecting your alertness pathways, usually like a location in the brainstem. High pressure can cause it. Seizures can cause it. The post-ictal phase, which is that period right after a seizure, is when people are often very sleepy and tired. And the seizure medications themselves can cause lethargy and sleepiness. So what to do is tell your doctor, make sure it's not a high pressure issue, and try and address the cause if it's from medications, if we need to make some changes to the medications. There are medications that can improve alertness. So we can try steroids, and we can also try modafinil or Provigil. Fatigue. So a lot of different causes for this. So the treatments, chemotherapy, radiation can both cause fatigue. If there's insomnia, not getting enough sleep, then you can get fatigue. Anemia, which can be from the chemotherapy, can cause some fatigue. And another aspect of it is just kind of the the social aspect of it. So just the busy schedule, especially during radiation, you have like the radiation appointment, all these, the radiation session, the doctor's appointments, physical therapy appointments, can be very tiring to have to do all of that. And especially if you live far away and have a long way to travel. So what to do, try to address the causes, and check for other causes. So your primary care doctor can help with this, checking if, is there a vitamin D issue or thyroid issue that can be contributing. So build up stamina with the physical activity, but being careful not to overdo it. Multivitamins and diet changes. Making sure that you're getting all the nutrients you need and not having a diet heavy in like carbs and sugar, because that can cause some fatigue. Cognitive symptoms. So this can be a wide variety of symptoms, things like forgetfulness, confusion, difficulty with thought processing, difficulty planning. This can be caused by the tumor location, especially the temporal lobe for memory. Chemotherapy, anxiety, depression, and insomnia. So addressing the causes. Many people think speech therapy is just, working on things like speech and swallowing, but they can also do cognitive testing, and cognitive exercises. And just on your own, just anything to kind of help keep the brain sharp, puzzles, Sudoku, crosswords, that can help with some of these cognitive symptoms. Mood and personality changes. So things like depression, anxiety, irritability, impulsiveness. They can be caused by the tumor location, so frontal lobe. Medications like Keppra and steroids. And even just coping, you have this new diagnosis, it's really scary, and coping with the symptoms and with the financial situation. If the insurance is giving a hard time and high copays, that's all very stressful. What to do, address the causes to the extent that we can, especially if it's from medications, psychiatry and psychology. So psychiatrists do prescribe the medications, and psychologists do more of like the talk therapy and counseling. Social work can help with providing some resources, especially like financial support and things like that. Finding support groups, finding activities you enjoy together or distractions, and just being patient with yourself. It's natural to get frustrated when your loved one is having these personality changes, and just try not to take it personally. I know it's easier said than done.
Dr. T, we are running a bit over. I don't want to shorten this up because this is really okay. Information, but I just want to let you know we are over time.
Okay, thank you. I'll be done probably I'm just wrapping up, so just a couple minutes. Thank you. So I just wanted to highlight the care team. So we have a whole team of people to help you through all these symptoms. Want to especially point out the palliative care specialist. So a lot of people think palliative care means hospice, like giving up and like withdrawing care, but they are important throughout this journey, and they're great with managing the symptoms, so you can continue with treatment but also have palliative care helping managing the symptoms. And so the main takeaway from this, I hope you not to scare you with all the different symptoms that can happen. Remember that not everyone will get these symptoms, but things to kind of watch out for. And I do want to emphasize that we have many tools to manage them. And I wanted to, before I move on to kind of tips for caregivers, I wanted to take any questions about all these symptoms.
Sadie, do you want to go ahead with that second question? I'm going to try and answer the first.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Dr. Tadipatri. Hi, everyone. My name's Sadie. I am a social worker and work closely with Dr. Tadipatri in neuro-oncology, and I'm asking some questions this morning as well. So we have one for you from Abby that says, my cousin just had her brain tumor removed this past Wednesday and is having language issues and reading is hard. I understand this is common post-surgery. How long does that typically last after brain surgery?
So thank you for the question. So the language issues after brain surgery, it's very difficult to predict how long it's going to last. You know, everybody's different. Things like your age and your what we call your performance status, how well you were functioning before the surgery, are things that help to predict how quickly you'll recover. So younger patients and patients that were higher functioning, we would expect a faster recovery. And it really depends too on the tumor location and what the surgery involved. So I think that it is kind of case by case, and your surgeon will probably be able to give you the best estimate of what to expect as far as the recovery course. And things like speech therapy again will be what optimizes the recovery. It speeds it up and also allows for the greatest amount of recovery.
Thank you.
All right. And I just wanted to close off with tips for caregivers really quick. So ask questions more than once. We are throwing a lot at you, especially when you're first getting this diagnosis. It's overwhelming, and we don't expect you to take it all in like a sponge. So we expect you to ask questions more than once. So and no question is too trivial, and there's no such thing as a stupid question. Take notes and stay organized. So that can help some people. It's like learning a new language, and it's a lot to take in and a lot to keep track of. And prioritize, you know, just one step at a time, and one problem at a time, one day at a time, to keep from getting too overwhelmed. Find support groups. Look forward. So it's easy to kind of look back and think, oh, what if I found this earlier? Like, wonder if was it something that we did to cause this brain tumors? We've looked at all different environmental risk factors, and we haven't really found any clear cause. So a lot of the times, it is just bad luck and nothing that you did. So you're not responsible for this. And many times even providers miss some of these symptoms. So things like headaches, because they're just so common. So don't beat yourself up, just look forward, try and stay optimistic. And at the same time, we don't expect you to be able to be optimistic all the time. So be patient with yourself. It's okay to get frustrated become despondent, but we're going to support you. There are going to be a lot of ups and downs, and we're going to support you the best we can through this process, and make time for self-care. So if you take care of yourself, that allows you to be in the best position to take care of your loved ones. And it's not selfish. It's important. And don't hesitate at all to ask for help. We are here to support you in whatever way that we can. And I wanted to open up to any caregivers if you had other tips to share from your experience.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Tadipatri. That was really good information and definitely some points to remember closing off this conversation. So thank you again for your time. Since we did go over, we're going to cut the break a little short. We're going to just take a few minutes, and we're going to come back at 9:20, and we'll hear from Dr. Billy Kennedy on radiation.
Thank you, Jackie.
Thank you.